Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And it's so nice to say ladies, because in the past it was just a gentleman. But these days it's so pleasing to see that we have a number of gentlemen, but also a number of ladies. Over the next 45, 50 minutes, we're going to cover tidal energy. It's quite a big topic. Bear with me, and obviously at the end you could ask questions. Just as an overview of what I'm going to cover, introduction, then talk about the resource, then give you the state of the art today, some projects and where each one is, barriers, and then draw some conclusions. And as you realize, I'm Greek, and all the Greeks go back to the origins, but also I'm an academic. And if we look at the earliest research that has taken place, we go back to 350 BC, Alexander the Great period. The philosopher Aristotle left Athens for 4 years and went close to Marathon with his students and studied the tidal effects on the Straits of Euripus. A few years later, another Greek, Pytheas, Marseille at that time was a Greek colony, traveled towards Britain and recorded tidal movements on the Atlantic, and these are the oldest references of tidal movements that we have on the world today. Now, about tides. We can see the bulging of the oceans, and all this is because of gravity and the interaction between the Earth, the Moon, and the Sun. So we have the predominant effect of the gravity of the Moon to the Earth, and also the Earth-Moon system revolving around the Sun as well. That produces tidal ranges. This is a global distribution chart from EPRI in California. And you can see red is probably the best resource here. And where we are at the British Isles, we have some of the best tidal resource in the world. There are some other high spots, as you can see, and some are too far away to be of any use. But here in the UK, we have a lot of positives, as we're going to see. Now, just as a starting point, looking at the British government and the Department of Energy and Climate Change, it does state that there are a lot of benefits of working on wave and tidal energy. It's going to save 61 metric tons of carbon dioxide by 2025, translated into 1.1 billion to the UK economy, and also it will help the UK's renewable energy objectives. And what they state is that marine energy could give us up to 20% of the UK's current electricity demand, and that represents about 30 to 50 gigawatts installed capacity. And also the fact that today the UK is seen as world leader, a focal point for any development of marine energy technologies, but it states that further research is needed to determine how best to exploit these assets. So work is ongoing. Looking at tidal resource, focusing now, we can see that globally we have 3 terawatts. Out of that, 1 terawatt is the technically harvestable part of this resource, and in areas that are close to the coast, so we don't have other problems. And we have a large number of countries, and that includes the UK, that we have very high tidal ranges. And in Europe, the harvestable estimate is about 12 gigawatts. And some deployment projections for tidal current by 2020, we're talking about 200 megawatts. And up to today, that's 2014, we have about 6 megawatts of tidal current, and out of this 6, 5 megawatts is deployed here in the UK. The technologies we are developing at the moment are around 2.5 meters per second. But obviously, as you will see later on, there are cases that we need to look into much smaller velocities than that, specifically with ocean currents. A lot of benefits with tides, highly predictable, can generate both day and night, and it's hardly influenced by weather conditions. How it works? The rise and fall of the tides can create potential energy. And the rise can be up to 16 meters. The highest is the Bay of Fundy in Canada, and this is where we have the Annapolis plant, and that's about 16.2 meters. Here in the UK, it's a bit lower than that, 10, 12. Also, the flows due to the flood and ebb create kinetic energy. And here you can see the Siemens marine current turbine SeaGen at the Strangford Lock. And on these two pictures I put there, you can see the resource that is about 7 knots, that's about 3.5 meters per second. And you see the energy that is available at this specific location. In this instance, we're using turbines that are similar to wind turbines, but they're smaller because the density of the water is 800 times denser than water, 1,000 against 1.2. And the blades are smaller, they turn more slowly, but they experience much greater forces. So we can actually tap both forms of energy, potential and kinetic. And we can use different technologies. At one end, we can use the well-developed bulb turbines, like the ones that have been used at Lawrence, Alstom design, or Siwa Andrich design, that they are very efficient, performing above 90 and approaching mid-90s. At the other extreme, you have the turbines that on horizontal axis could look similar to wind turbines that are limited by the batch limit, and the best efficiencies on the world at the moment are just on the high 40s, below 50%. And something in between. Moving in this direction, you have decreasing power density, and moving the opposite direction, you have increasing environmental impact. So there are different solutions for different applications. It's not something new. We have tidal energy technologies from 700 AD in Europe. That's after Roman time, Byzantine Empire. But between 1960 and today, we have had about 5 projects developed. and I'll go through this. Then, between 2006 and today, we had more than 40 new devices that have been developed. Most of them are vertical or horizontal, and in some cases are ducted to increase velocities. Doubling the velocity, you can increase your power 8 times. And so far, we have done quite a lot of work on single turbines, and the next step is that we are focusing now is developing arrays of turbines. If we look at the EMEC website, European Marine Energy Center, the Orkneys, or the US Department of Energy, we can see there are more than 150 devices registered there. And these are the registered ones. There are many that are not even registered. So there are plenty of devices out there. And if we try to categorize them, maybe we can split them in horizontal axis, rigidly mounted or floating and submerged, vertical axis, hydrofoil, Venturi systems, Archimedes screw, tidal kite, and if they don't fit in these 5-6 basic categories, we can have others as well. The majority are horizontal axis machines, 76%, and 12% vertical axis. And from the research point of view, 76% went to tidal current turbines with horizontal axis, 4% on ducted turbines, and 2% into vertical axis. Now, looking at projects to date, just trying to develop the state of the art, we see that up to 2010, the industry was dominated by small companies, university spin-offs. But in the last 4 years, from 2010 up to today, we see major companies joining the game and becoming even more interesting. We see ABB, Alstom, Andritz Hydro, DCNS, Hyundai Heavy Industries, Kawasaki Heavy Industries, Siemens and Voith Hydro entering the market. Also, we see General Electric developing a keen interest to supply the electrical power systems for some of these prototypes. And utilities, like Board Gas Energy, EDF, GDF Suez, and Iberdrola are running demonstration projects. I was recently in Taiwan, and there they have a different type of resource that doesn't fit the UK spec of 2.5 meters per second, and they have completely different needs. There they have the black current, Kuroshio, that it's very wide, 300 kilometers, close to the surface, but it's less than 2 meters per second. It's closer to 1 meter per second. So they have different needs there, and we call that ocean current. So there are applications now for a different spec, and there is work that is taking place there and also in Florida to cover this element. I would have thought that some of these applications could be ideal for the UK as well, especially UK estuaries, like Morecambe Bay, as an example, not far away from Lancaster. Again, I was not far away, not so long ago, in Ireland, and there they have come up with a fish-friendly idea of open hydro, where the blades, instead of being mounted on a central shaft, they're actually mounted on a peripheral ring and a direct drive approach to give extra benefits to this design. Now, looking at the first category, horizontal axis machines, you see they're operating like wind turbines under the sea. And I'll just pass quickly through your eyes the number of devices that have been tested over the last and developed over the last few years. Now these devices have a completely different methods of being fixed to the seabed. We can see some are using gravity base, some pile mounted, floating, and hydrofoil downforce. Pile mounted is, for instance, marine current turbines, Siemens. They started with a monopile and they moved to a new tripod system. Floating is Alstom. Alstom is working with individual components that can be mounted on different kinds of mooring structures. Now you can see that there are all sorts of different designs that have been developed and recorded over the last few years, starting now obviously with even bigger companies, both Siemens and many others from all over the world, really. You see Canada, USA, and Hammerfest initially in Norway, and now belongs to Austrian Andritz, and many others. Again, you can see many different designs that some have not progressed so well, but I'll really highlight the ones that are really the forerunners today. Again, vertical axis turbines follow similar trends. The vertical axis turbines, we have a plethora of ideas and how they can operate. You can see the Gorlov turbine, helical turbine developed in the States, and the massive idea of Professor Stephen Salter and many others, Cobalt in the Straits of Messina. And a lot of universities are carrying out specialist designs with to improve efficiency, like at Lancaster we're doing work with flaps, like on Formula One cars and airplanes. Even Mexico are coming up with their own ideas, their own designs. Also, we have reciprocating devices that operate in that form. Here is just an airfoil that moves up and down as the tide is passing through. And again, we have many different designs. Stingray, Pulse, Barstream, and many others, both translating and oscillating devices. Then we have Venturi effect and also ducted turbines. And again, the idea here is that you might add extra material and extra cost and complexity, but you increase velocities. As I said, doubling your velocity, you increase your power 8 times. An example here is the Rotec Tidal turbine and many others. Other ideas that have been developed recently include Archimedes screw as a tidal device, and a lot of experiments have been made in a lot of universities. Lancaster has done some work there as well. And tidal kites. Obviously, everybody has maybe played when we were young with kites. Air and water are both fluids, so this is an underwater kite. That it's another idea that is being developed as we speak. And a lot of other systems that obviously do not fit into these six basic categories. Now, we reach a stage that we have developed and we have learned quite a lot on single devices. But really, single devices are limited on power. And the idea is to, as a next step, to move on to arrays of these devices. And we need to carry out a lot of research, for instance, on special arrangements, so we know how far apart we can place them, in what form we can place them. Some projects are progressing, and here you can see the idea of the Andritz Hydro Hammerfest project that they are planning at the Sound of Islay, here between the island of Islay in Scotland and Jura Island. Now, grid connection is an important element, and we need to pay a lot of attention on grid. Each turbine is connected with each other at 33 kV. Then you use 150 kV from offshore substation to onshore substation, and then eventually to the grid. With wind turbines, we learned quite a lot about offshore AC and DC, but the grid connection is a very critical aspect. And especially if you're offshore, costs can escalate. Now, who are the project developers? We can see a lot of countries being involved, including obviously the UK. And a lot of countries that are involved are developing their own testing centers. We're the first ones to develop the EMEC, the European Marine Energy Center, in 2005, and we are developing now globally new test sites that will be operational shortly. And suddenly we see in the last couple of years new big companies entering the field. So suddenly you see movements like Andritz by Hamfer Strom, MCT now becoming part of Siemens, ABB investing in Scots Renewables, Alstom acquiring Tidal Generation Limited, DCNS taking over Open Hydro and developing projects in various countries, Hyundai Heavy Industries, Kawasaki Heavy Industries, and GDF Suez supporting the development of Sabella in France. So we see a lot of movement over the last couple of years. Now, who is ahead of the pack? So far, we had marine current turbines, we thought, but really today, if you have, if you look closer, you can see Andritz Hydro Hammerfest are coming up there, Alstom, DCNS with Open Hydro, Scott Renewables, MCT Siemens, and also Void Hydro. All of them with 1 megawatt, Atlantis with 1.5 megawatt, collaborating with Lockheed Martin. And out of all these technologies, we can see that the ones that are moving towards tidal arrays, and they are working from this year up to the year 2016, are three: MCT Siemens, and possibly Alstom, and also Andritz Hydro Hammerfest. But obviously we have further development, like in April this year, DCNS, Open Hydro, and Alderney Renewable announced plans to have a 300 megawatt tidal array. And work is still important to carry out on model development. But at the same time, we have smaller technologies that can operate as onshore, like the Tokardo turbines in Holland. And also we've heard quite a lot about the Verdant turbine in USA. And also now near Australia, hydrogen testing in the Torres Straits. So I just put a question mark there. Really, who is closest to the commercialization? I can see these technologies being at the forefront at the moment and have put a lot of resources of massive conglomerates like Andritz Hydro, for instance, that they're massive, or Siemens or Alstom. And we'll see what the next step will be. And this is for tidal current. Now, if we focus on tidal rains, we can see that worldwide we have a potential of 500 to 1,000 terawatt hours per year. In 2014, we had a tidal range deployment of 514 megawatts. The resource in the UK is 50 terawatt hours per year. And this represents half of the European resource, 48%. But the benefit here in the UK is that we can produce electricity close to the users. And also we have transmission grids that are close to the users as well. And from studies that have taken place here in the UK back in the 80s, we have identified 16 estuaries that can produce 44 out of this 50 terawatt hours per year resource we have, and this concentrates in 8 major estuaries. And in rank of order, 7, Solway, Morecambe Bay, Wash, Humber, Thames, Mersey, and Dee. So, in tidal rains, we had development in France in the 60s, Canada in the 80s, then similar years in China and Russia, and this is between 60s and 70s development. In Canada it was a bit later. And recently, in 2012, we have the development of the largest tidal range project in the world in Korea, South Korea, the Siwa project. Because of environmental implications and other problems we experienced at the Severn, we have developed new ideas, more environmentally friendly solutions like lagoons, reefs, fences, or ultra-low head tidal barrages. And I'll go through this individually. So, the reference list globally to date is shown on just one slide here for convenience. And you can see as a starting point back in the 60s, we have Lawrence in Saint-Malo with Alstom technology. Then we have the Kislaya Guba in Russia. Then the Annapolis project in 80. You can see it here, Bear Fundy in Canada. At the same time, we have some projects at Jiangxia in China. And obviously in 2011, we have the Siwa project, the largest on the world today that is now fully operational and connected to the grid. Just looking a bit closer on each one of them, Lawrence is the first. We're talking about 8 meters tidal range, and a diameter of the runner, 5.4 meters. You can see an engineer inside the runner here, just to see the scale of it. Even larger in diameter, you're talking about from there to there, 7.6 meters, is the Straflo design of Andritz at Annapolis in Canada. Just one blade, one turbine, is producing 20 megawatts. And you can see even more now, better the scale of the 7.5 meters diameter runners at the Siwa project in South Korea. And you can see a man there in comparison, and lorries just coming in and out. New ideas and more environmentally friendly ideas are reefs, lagoons, and fences. Reefs are barrages that, instead of using 5 to 10 meters differential head, we reduce it down to 2 to 3 meters. So it doesn't cause such a big environmental problem, but the downside is that the power produced is reduced significantly because of the reduced head. Tidal lagoons, similar to tidal barrages, but they can be offshore or connected to the land. And we know that at the moment, Swansea Bay is moving forward fast with a tidal lagoon there. Ultra low head techniques. Now, a lot of universities are carrying out research. Lancaster does, involved with Grevelingen project in Holland, where in the 60s, the Dutch, because of flooding, they developed dikes. These estuaries began producing environmental problems, fish, plants, and stagnant water could be smelly. So you affects tourism. So they want to come up with new ideas how they can actually solve that environmental problem, but with an environmentally friendly technology. So there we're talking about a turbine that will be able to operate between 1 meter and 50 centimeters. And these are the specifics of this project in Holland. And other ideas include tidal fences and all that. Again, we don't have an example of this. They are at early stages of development, probably the one that is ahead at the moment because of the requirements of the Dutch government is the Grevelingen Lake. And I'll show you some more pictures on that. So looking at the different barrage systems, we can have single or double basin. We can have tidal lagoons offshore or connected to land, like the latest proposal for Swansea Bay. We could have tidal reefs where we have minimum head difference between the two sides of the barrage. So bring it down to 2 to 3 meters. So we are having an environmentally friendly solution. Or tidal fences, some of the ideas we thought of for Morecambe Bay, maybe back in 2004. And how it works. This is Swansea. This is the proposal of Swansea Lagoon with turbines here. People can actually go for walks, or you can have roads there or whatever. But you can see that the way it operates is you have a barrage here. Lagoon C, you have some valves that you can create a differential head between the two sides and then pass all this water through turbines and produce electricity. And you can do that both ways. Recently, that's probably mid of this year, Poirier from Oxford came up with some costs specifically for Swansea Bay Lagoon, and they found out that it's cheaper than offshore wind, and some would be cost comparable to nuclear generation. So they costed the first, the second, and third lagoon, and they have come up with prices 168 first, 130 the second, and down to 92 megawatts per hour for the third, and really with an average of 111 megawatts per hour, assuming a 35-year CFD duration. Now, the lowering of the cost is not because of learning curves, it's because we are moving to bigger sites. And the levelized cost of electricity for the first lagoons on volume weighted basis, it's around 100 megawatt hours per hour. Now, we need to consider that projects like tidal projects are not designed for the typical 25, 30 years like any other energy projects. We are designing them for 120 years. So there are many benefits there. Now, how we operate these projects? We can have one-way power generation with ebb, or flood, or two ways with pumping. For instance, ebb application is Annapolis in Canada. Flood generation is the Siwa in Korea. And two-way and pumping, it's Lawrence. So depending on exactly what we want, we can actually play tunes with the operation of these plants, especially if we need to consider changes of operation mode over a 120 years period. Let's just say on one slide about the seven, because it's the largest one we have here in the UK. Back in 2008 and 9, we had some exploratory studies that we could generate enough electricity equivalent to maybe several nuclear power stations. In 2010, the government thought that these two riskiest costs were high, and we had environmental and ecological issues. We looked into embryonic technologies, like we said about tidal reefs and lagoons and others, fences. Then private companies like Hafren moved on with further studies, and now in 2012 another company, is looking at it. But in parallel, we can see that Swansea Bay Tidal Lagoon is really progressing and receiving green lights from both the Welsh government and the London government at the moment. But in 2013, DEC said that we could not see a strategic case for public investment at the moment for the Severn Estuary, so it is left up to private consortiums that are progressing with it. Also, we have developed hybrids and DTP. Now, DTP is dynamic tidal power. And there are many proposals in Canada, China, Netherlands, Norway, and also in the UK. For instance, just to give you an example, in Norway, the Ministry of Public Transport, they have come up with the Norwegian, this is Norway here, and they have come up with a plan to develop a north-south, south E39 road. And this is a road, this is the Ministry of Public Transport, but they want to ensure that all sorts of different renewable energy sources are mounted on these structures. And they are designed in such a way that, for instance, tidal, as you can see, is ideally placed in this overall design. So that's a clever way of maybe minimizing the costs of the project by making it part of a multifunctional infrastructure. We have hybrids like Grevelingen that we try to solve an environmental problem by producing energy. Again, in the Siwa project in Korea, we try to solve an environmental problem again, because again, it was a lake that had environmental problems. This is why it is operating in exactly the opposite way. It operates from sea to the lake only. And we're talking about hybrids and DTPs, the dynamic tidal power. This is, imagine a massive T that it can be 30 to 60 kilometers long. where it's open, we don't have environmental problems. And because of this massive T, we can see that we generate a pressure differential ahead between the two sides. And we can actually put turbines there and generate electricity. That's another hybrid form that we could use. And there are many project developers that they are progressing with this. We have in Canada, and Ross Hydro are looking into projects in Australia. And we mentioned about Siwa, Grevelinken, and also Canada. An example of tidal range planning we can see here in one slide of what's happening in South Korea. So in South Korea, they are thinking of 2.6 megawatts. So we're talking about more than two nuclear power stations there on a series of tidal barrage projects that they have planned for. Future developments, we can see that a number of countries around the world are progressing, includes the United Kingdom. A lot of feasibility studies are progressing. Costs, we have already established costs from plants that are operating, like Lawrence and Siwa. So we have fixed costs there. And also we are planning, we have cost indications for new projects. And new projects may be here in the UK and Europe, and maybe countries like India. There are a lot of barriers and a lot of drivers. Some of the problems are relatively high upfront costs and ecological implications, but also there are some positives that we can use a barrage to on existing situations where you can actually solve an environmental problem. Technological problems perhaps increase efficiencies, and this is an area that we are actively looking at and looking to new materials and transfer knowledge between different industries, for instance from oil and gas into tidal. Ecological impact, ideally we need to ensure that from day one of each project we address any ecological impact that we might have at a specific site. Now we can see some movement forward because we didn't have this industrial cohesion up to now. As I said, companies were just spin-offs from university projects, and now we see big conglomerates, big companies like ABB, Alstom, Andritz, Siemens, and Voith coming forward, and this is positive. We need new finance mechanisms in general. We can see how different countries around the world, including the UK, are trying to progress with these policies, and grid infrastructure, which is quite a big problem for tidal, but it's a general problem for renewable energies as well. Again, planning and licensing, it needs to be looked at in more detail. Ideally, we need to look into multifunctional infrastructure and power generation. So far, we are costing every single project here in the UK as a power generation project. But I come from Lancaster, so Carlisle is not too far away. Every single year we have flooding of Carlisle. Obviously this year we had flooding further down in England as well. If you incorporate the cost of flooding when you build a project like that, then the power generation project becomes better. And if you include transport, tourism, and job creation and other elements, maybe we could look into the finances of that in a different light, make it more, make it better to progress. So ideally we have to look at it as a multifunctional integration project. And examples I mentioned, an Norwegian road administration project, the road E39 from north to south. Something similar we are trying to push forward now with the Northwest Business Leadership Team, where we have a series of multifunctional tidal gateways along the northwest coast of England. And this is happening as we speak. And other projects include the MODEC in Japan, where in Japan they try to have a vertical axis turbine and a tidal, vertical axis tidal device on the same floating structure. And here you can see some of the projects in the Northwest. This is Liverpool, the MESI project that is being progressed with PL Holdings, PL Energy. Solway, between Annan in Scotland and Bowness near Carlisle. The Wyre, Morecambe Bay. And this is the model that the Northwest Business Leadership Team is progressing with this Northwest Energy Squared model. So policy is based on mainly on increasing security of energy supply, reducing costs and environmental effects, and every country is using a different aspect of this toolbox here. And just to conclude within my time, we can see that the UK has substantial potential for tidal, about 20% of present UK demand. So we have 8 major estuaries that are able to meet about 10% of electricity demand. Tidal stream, about 5%. Just looking at the Northwest, for instance, just from barrages, at least 5% of electricity, and this represents about 50% of the region's electricity. So we need to have effective tidal energy policies, and this is a challenge for engineers and scientists, an opportunity for the UK, and engineers like you and me, we can solve problems, and as long as the politicians can provide leadership and remove the barriers and allow sufficient time for some potentially spectacular successes. Thank you very much.